Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Multiple Sclerosis for Dummies, Second Edition, by Rosalind Kalb, PhD, Barbara Giesser, MD, and Kathleen Costello, ANP-BC. Narrated by Exy Sands. Foreword. I had just started law school at the University of Virginia when my sister called and asked if she could visit me in Charlottesville. She had something to tell me. It was the fall of 1983, and I had moved from Richmond to begin 3 years at UVA trying to learn what it was the lawyers actually did. Back then, my sister was a newspaper reporter. When I was in college, I went with her on some of her reporting beats. She attended town council meetings and spoke with citizens gathering to query their elected representative. She was the ultimate professional. To her, the truth was paramount. So when she came to UVA, I expected her to tell me that she had taken another job at another newspaper. I had always assumed that my sister would end up working for the Washington Post, or maybe even the New York Times. We started walking around campus. She talked, but quite frankly, all I could think about was my new life. I wanted to tell her about what I was doing, feeling, thinking. She kept speaking quietly, and I kept nodding, and my mind kept wandering to what I would say when she had finished. But then I focused, something I should have done when she first started speaking. "I have MS," she said. In an instant, UVA and my law career were forgotten. I sat down next to her. I looked at her closely. She didn't look sick. I remember we used to collect money for the Jerry Lewis telethon when we were kids, but that was muscular dystrophy. Those kids all looked desperately ill. "What are the doctors gonna do?" I asked her. "What they can," she replied. She paused. "It's chronic," she added. "There is no cure. I'll have it for the rest of my life." My sister's life had changed, and that day so had mine. I soon discovered that so much misinformation is out there about MS. Although it's still one of the most misdiagnosed diseases, more worthy and helpful information sources are available. Multiple Sclerosis for Dummies, Second Edition, is one of them. It helps to empower those individuals who have MS, as well as their family, friends, and other members of their support team. It helps one navigate the field of chronic illness, making complex issues less so, helping to sort, organize, and make comprehensible so much that is disorganized and incomprehensible about MS. Yet Multiple Sclerosis for Dummies, Second Edition, is not simply a book on the disease. It is a tool with which to live, offering practical advice, anecdotal experiences, humor, and most importantly of all, hope. It shows that no one with MS is alone. A broad community exists of those individuals with MS and a broader support group composed of family, friends, and healthcare professionals. No one book can be a cure-all or the only source one turns to. Yet this book is also a gateway to many other sources of information and provides those resources throughout its chapters. It can lead folks to where they need to go in seeking help, understanding, and even an opportunity to smile or laugh. As an author, I can tell you that books make great friends. For those with MS, this book will not only make a great friend, it will also stay with you for the long haul. You can turn to it again and again for knowledge, comfort, and a way to help you or your loved one control the disease instead of the other way around. No one can say that researchers are winning the war against MS yet, and it continues to challenge and at times overwhelm the people it affects, along with their families and friends. But what MS can't do is unilaterally rob people of their spirit to fight it and to live life on their terms, despite changes in the brain and body. The human spirit is wonderfully resilient. In fact, it may be the most powerful defense mechanism any of us has. Multiple Sclerosis for Dummies, Second Edition, is a terrific resource to have at one's side. It can lift the fog of an inscrutable disease, bring a smile to one's face when it is desperately needed, and bring hope when things look hopeless. A lot of power is packed into the book. I encourage anyone with MS, their family, and friends to use it. David Baldacci. Introduction. Being diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, MS, is definitely a bummer, but living with it doesn't have to be. This book is all about how to live your life with MS without making a full-time job of it. After diving in, you'll be more informed and more prepared, no matter how your MS behaves. If you've never heard of MS before, and you want to know what may be in store, this book is definitely for you. You also want to take a gander through this book if all you've ever heard about MS is the bad stuff. We suggest this because the fact is you've probably met several people at work, at the gym, or in your neighborhood who have MS, and you didn't even know it. And even if the people you happen to know with MS don't seem to have a symptom or care in the world, you now have another good reason to keep listening. Everyone's MS is different, and no one can predict exactly what yours will be like. The three of us, a neurologist, a nurse, and a psychologist, have worked with and learned from people with MS for a total of 88 years, if you add our careers together end to end. We wrote this book as a team effort so we could send a loud and clear message that you're not alone. Health professionals trained in neurology, nursing, psychology, rehabilitation medicine, and the variety of other disciplines, as well as voluntary organizations such as the National Multiple Sclerosis Society, are ready to help you every step of the way. About this book. Don't worry. In this second edition of Multiple Sclerosis for Dummies, we're not going to try to tell you everything there is to know about MS. Instead, we only give you what you need in order to make educated choices and comfortable decisions, including new and updated info about medications to slow disease progression and manage MS symptoms, recent and anticipated changes in healthcare reform in the United States, and exciting news on the research front. We provide lots of information that's easy to access and easy to swallow regarding what happens in MS, what kinds of symptoms it can cause, how it can affect your life at home and at work, what you can do to feel and function up to snuff, and how you can protect yourself and your family against the long-term unpredictability of the disease. We also throw in useful tips, introduce you to the members of your healthcare team, and point you in the direction of a growing array of useful resources. And we even promise to make you chuckle once or twice along the way. Feel free to pick and choose what you want to listen to. You don't have to take a start-to-finish approach if you're more comfortable with a hop-skip-and-jump style. Each chapter tackles a different aspect of living with MS so that you can zero in on the stuff that's most relevant to you. Conventions used in this book. We use the following conventions throughout the audiobook to make things consistent and easy to understand. Because most people with MS receive their MS-related care from a neurologist, a physician who specializes in the diagnosis and treatment of diseases of the nervous system, we use the terms neurologist, doctor, and physician interchangeably whenever we're referring to the person who's treating your MS. When we're talking about other medical specialists, such as internists, family practice doctors, urologists, gynecologists, physiatrists, psychiatrists, we refer to them by their specialty titles. We talk a lot about medications in this book, which you may or may not ever need. In case you do, we always give the brand name first because that's the one you're most likely to see in advertisements or hear other people talk about, followed by the chemical name. What you're not to hear. Even though we poured heart and soul into every section of this book, we know that you won't want to listen to it all, and most likely you won't need to. So we make it easy for you to identify skippable material by sticking it into sidebars. This is the stuff that's interesting and related to the topic at hand, but not essential for your health and well-being. Foolish assumptions. Even though no two people have MS in exactly the same way, we assume that you, our listeners, still have quite a few things in common. We've written this book with these thoughts about you in mind. You have MS, or care about someone who does. However much you already know about MS, you want to know more, in language that's easy to access and easy to understand. You're looking for ways to manage your MS and the symptoms it can cause. You want to be healthy, active, and productive in spite of whatever challenges MS is throwing your way. You wish you had a crystal ball, but you're willing to settle for some helpful suggestions on how to deal with the unpredictability of MS. How this book is organized. This book is divided into 6 parts to help you gather all the information you need about MS. However, every part can stand alone, so you don't have to listen to one before another. The following is a rundown of the 6 parts. Part 1. When MS becomes part of your life. Whether MS has entered your life with a bang or a whimper, you need to know what it's all about. So, in this part, we fill you in on the basic facts as well as the big mysteries that remain to be solved. We show you the usual steps involved in getting a diagnosis and suggest ways to handle any reactions that you may have during those early days, as well as those that may crop up as the realities of the disease begin to sink in. This part also gives you good ideas on how to begin making room in your life for a chronic, unpredictable illness without giving it more attention than it needs. It's always good to know that you don't have to deal with tough stuff on your own, so in this part, we also spend some time introducing you to the healthcare professionals who are going to help you manage your MS. Part 2. Taking charge of your MS. The best way to feel more confident in the face of any new challenge is to come up with a game plan. And you're in luck because this part of the book is designed to do just that. It helps you get started with the planning process and gives you tips on how to work with your healthcare team to make the treatment choices that best meet your needs. Each chapter describes a part of the MS treatment package, including all the immediate and longer-term strategies for slowing disease activity, dealing with pesky relapses, and managing symptoms. We talk about the importance of early treatment and describe each of the available options in detail. And we zero in on ways to manage the physical symptoms that can pop up along the way, as well as the ones that can mess with your head, such as mood changes and problems with memory and thinking. Alternative medicine is a hot topic for people with MS, so in this part we also give you pointers on how to sift through the available products and services to find those that are safe and effective for people with MS. And we fill you in on the latest information about a controversial topic in the MS world, chronic cerebrospinal venous insufficiency, CCSVI. Part 3. Staying healthy and feeling well. You can be healthy with MS. In fact, the healthier you are, the better you're going to feel. So this part is all about how to take care of yourself with a healthy, balanced diet, the right kind of exercise, restful sleep, and some good stress management strategies. Throughout the chapters of this part, we emphasize the importance of looking beyond your MS or your family member's MS to develop an overall wellness plan involving regular checkups by your family doctor and dentist and the preventative health screens recommended for your age group. In this part, we also give you an idea of what to do when your MS isn't behaving very nicely. When the disease progresses in spite of available treatments, it's important to know how to manage your symptoms, avoid messy complications, and keep your life on track. Part 4. Managing lifestyle issues. The key to coping well with your MS is finding ways to fit it into your life. So in this part, we begin with a reminder that people's responses to your MS depend in large part on how you present it to them. We then go on to give you strategies for helping others understand what your MS is all about. We also include a chapter that shows how to make MS part of the family. This chapter describes the ways in which families are affected when someone they love gets MS, and it also shares tips to help family members communicate and problem solve more comfortably. Because MS is diagnosed most often during early adulthood, when people are busy starting or adding to their families, this part fills you in on all the good news for prospective parents. Yes, people with MS can have happy, healthy kids. It gives you lots of parenting tips to help you deal with those bundles of joy that quickly grow into toddlers and teens. Part 5. Creating your safety nets. The hallmark of MS is its unpredictability. Because everyone's MS is different and no one has a crystal ball, anxiety about the future is pretty common. To reduce that anxiety as much as possible, this part is all about making sure that you're armed and ready to deal with whatever comes along. We give you tips on how to stay in the workforce as long as you're interested and able, strategies for getting and maintaining insurance coverage, and recommendations for how to plan effectively for the unpredictable future. When you're living with MS, developing these kinds of safety nets can help you feel less vulnerable and more in control. Part 6. The part of tens. In this part, we give you key information in a handy top 10 format. One chapter lists the mistaken notions about MS that you can finally put to rest, and another highlights 10 intriguing areas of MS research. We top off this part with 10 strategies to make traveling with MS as trouble-free as possible. Icons used in this book. To make this book easier and simpler to use, we include some icons that can help you pick out the key ideas and points of information throughout the book. Tip. This icon highlights shortcuts that help you conserve valuable resources such as energy, time, and money. Remember, this icon tells you that the information that follows is essential and that you should keep it in mind as you deal with your MS. Warning. This icon flags dangers to your health, safety, or general well-being. Call a pro. This icon reminds you when it's time to check in with your neurologist or another specialist on your healthcare team. Where to go from here? This book is organized so that all you need to do is shut your eyes and point in order to find complete information about one aspect of MS or another. If you prefer the eyes open method but aren't sure where you want to start, we recommend part one. It gives you basic info about MS and how it's diagnosed, as well as some tips for sorting out all of the feelings that an MS diagnosis can stir up. If you've already been there and done that, you may want to check out specific treatment strategies in part two, or discover ways to feel more bright-eyed and bushy-tailed in part three. If you're wondering how MS may affect your relationships with the important people in your life, you can focus on part four. And if you're someone who likes to get all your ducks in a row from the get-go, and even if you're not, you can check out part five for suggestions on how to feel securely prepared in spite of the unpredictability of MS. No matter where you choose to begin, begin now. Make it your priority to educate yourself about MS and the strategies you and your family members can use to live well in spite of it. Part one. When MS becomes part of your life. In this part, we're guessing that multiple sclerosis, MS, has recently become part of your life. Either you or someone you care about has been diagnosed with MS, and you're wondering what it's all about. This part gives you the big picture, starting with an overview of what doctors know and don't know about this chronic, unpredictable disease, and what you can do to live comfortably and productively in spite of it. The good news is that you aren't ever alone in your efforts to overcome the challenges of MS. Your healthcare team, which we introduce to you in this part, will always be right beside you. Chapter 1. Meeting MS Face-to-Face. In this chapter, exploring how MS affects your body, determining what triggers MS, recognizing the uniqueness of your MS, taking a peek at the available MS treatments, understanding the impact of MS on your family and work life, gearing up to keep your life on track. Because you've picked up this book, we're assuming that your doctor has delivered the news that you have multiple sclerosis, MS, or perhaps he or she said that you may have this disease or that you probably have this disease, which makes you wonder why you can't get a clear answer. Whether you got the news yesterday or several months ago, you're probably trying to figure out what it means for you, for your future, and for your family. In other words, you have about a zillion questions about what's in store. Chances are, the answers you've received so far haven't been all that satisfying, mostly because MS still can't be cured, no one knows what causes it, and no doctor can predict with any certainty how your MS is going to behave in the future. However, the good news is that the treatment options are expanding, and people with MS are busy getting on with their lives, and you will too. In this chapter, which is an introduction to MS and an overview of what we cover in the rest of the book, we fill you in on the available MS info, including what scientists have been able to discover about the workings of this disease and what questions remain to be answered. We explain why your MS is different from everyone else's, and we introduce you to the treatment strategies that can help you manage your MS. Finally, we glance at the ways that MS can affect life at home and at work, and we show you what you can do to ensure the best possible quality of life for you and the people you love. Introducing the roles your immune and nervous systems play in MS. Surprise! Even though MS is described as the most common neurologic disorder diagnosed in young adults, the problem doesn't appear to originate with the nervous system. Instead, decades of research have pointed to the body's immune system as the culprit. Some kind of malfunction in the immune system interferes with the functioning of the body's nervous system, resulting in the symptoms commonly associated with MS. The current thinking is that the glitch is an autoimmune problem, which basically means that your body is mistakenly destroying some of its own healthy tissues and cells. But this thinking has yet to be proven. We explain the autoimmune process in the section What Happens in MS later in the chapter, but for now, understanding how the immune system is supposed to work when it's healthy is important. The immune system, your body's frontline defender. The immune system, which is a complex network of glands, tissues, and circulating cells, is your body's frontline defense in the fight against infection by viruses, bacteria, and other bad guys. When confronted with an infection, the immune system gears up to neutralize the foreign invader and make you healthy again. Remember, in order for your immune system to do its job properly, it has to be able to distinguish between the good guys, the cells, tissues, and organs that make up your body, and the bad guys, any foreign invader, such as a virus or a bacteria that doesn't share your genes. And get this, the immune system is so powerful that it could reject a pregnant woman's developing fetus, which shares only some of her genes, if the hormones of pregnancy didn't suppress her immune system. Check out Chapter 16 to read more about how pregnancy hormones appear to affect MS. The nervous system, your body's CEO. The nervous system, which controls all bodily functions, is made up of neurons, each of which consists of a cell body and its long extension, the axon. And many axons are covered by a protective or insulating coating called myelin. The neurons are gathered into small and large-sized bundles called nerves. The system is basically divided into two parts. The central nervous system, CNS, which consists of the brain, spinal cord, and optic nerves, is the target of the damage done in MS. The peripheral nervous system, PNS, includes the branching network of nerves and axons that connects the CNS to muscles, sensory organs, and glands in the rest of the body. Remember, the nervous system conducts four basic kinds of electrical signals throughout the body. Motor signals. These signals, which move from the CNS through the PNS and to muscles and other organs, control movement, strength, and other bodily functions. Sensory signals. These signals go back to the CNS from the eyes, ears, skin, and other sensory organs, and they provide information about the environment from those organs. Autonomic signals. These signals go to your GI system, your bladder, your sexual organs, and other parts of the body that often act without conscious control. Integrative signals. These signals travel from nerve cell to nerve cell within the nervous system and are thought to be responsible for many cognitive functions, such as thinking and memory. Check out Chapter 9 for information about cognitive changes in MS. These electrical signals are like the current in an electrical wire. When everything is working fine, they travel long distances along the myelin-covered axons in the CNS, jumping from one axon to another as needed. The myelin, like the rubber or plastic insulation around an electrical wire, is what helps speed the electrical signals on their journey and smooths out any bumps along the way. What happens in MS? After you understand the role of the immune system and the nervous system, you can begin to understand how MS affects them. In autoimmune diseases like MS and rheumatoid arthritis, myasthenia gravis, and type 1 diabetes, among others, the immune system loses the ability to distinguish the good guys from the bad guys, and so it starts attacking the normal tissues in the body. In MS, this autoimmune response targets the myelin coating around the axons in the CNS, the axons themselves, and the cells that produce the myelin, called oligodendrocytes. Remember, the autoimmune attack happens because of a breakdown in the blood-brain barrier, BBB, which allows immune cells that have been living harmlessly in your blood to travel into your CNS to attack the myelin and axons, resulting in the symptoms associated with MS. The autoimmune process in MS follows these steps. 1. The inflammation that occurs during an MS relapse, also called an attack or exacerbation, damages the BBB, allowing the movement of immune cells into the CNS. Skip to Chapter 6 for more info about MS relapses. 2. Toxic substances are released into the CNS, which can increase inflammation and result in the breakdown of myelin in a process called demyelination, and the axons, sometimes even affecting the nerve cell bodies. 3. Nervous system cells called astrocytes move into the locations where the damage has occurred, and they form scar tissue, giving rise to the name multiple sclerosis, which means multiple scars. Remember, The results of the autoimmune process aren't all that pretty. The inflammation can cause swelling, which interferes with the conduction of signals in the nervous system. Demyelination results in a loss of insulation around the neuron's axons, which slows or interrupts nervous system conduction. And finally, the axons can be broken, a process referred to as axonal loss, which breaks the connections between the nervous system and parts of the body. This whole process results in the symptoms that we describe in chapters 7, 8, and 9. Flip to chapter 6 to read about the treatments that can reduce the inflammation and slow the destructive process. Taking advantage of the body's natural healing process. The body has a natural capacity to heal some of the damage caused by MS. For example, partial healing occurs following each MS relapse. Here's how it works. The inflammation that occurs during an MS relapse causes edema, the accumulation of fluids at the site of the damaged myelin. Picture what happens when you sprain your ankle. Edema results in swelling that compresses the myelin-coated axons and interferes with the transmission of nerve signals. As the inflammation and swelling disappear and the relapse comes to an end, some of the axons begin to decompress and are able to function normally again. The reduction of inflammation can happen through a natural healing process or can sometimes be speeded up with corticosteroid medications, which you can read about in Chapter 6. In addition, the myelin coating that has been damaged by the inflammation has some ability, but not a whole lot, to heal or regenerate. As long as the axon itself remains intact, the natural regeneration of myelin can smooth out the conduction of nerve impulses and result in some amount of improvement of symptoms over time. Check out the National MS Society website at nationalmssociety.org/myelin for more information on myelin and current research efforts to stimulate this natural healing process. Remember, after the nerve fiber itself has been damaged or severed and scar tissue has formed, healing is much more difficult. Unfortunately, doctors haven't yet found a way to repair damaged axons or to remove the scars. Researchers are focusing a lot of attention on how to promote this kind of repair, and this is precisely where stem cell research may be most relevant in MS. To read about stem cells and their potential value in the treatment of MS, go to nationalmssociety.org/stem cell. Exploring possible MS triggers. Assuming that MS is, in fact, an autoimmune disease, figuring out what actually triggers the immune system's attack on the nervous system is important. Most scientists agree that no single virus or bacterium causes MS all by itself. They have also concluded that no single thing in the environment or in a person's diet is directly responsible for the disease. Remember, currently, scientists believe that the disease is caused by a combination of several factors, including gender, racial or ethnic, geographic, genetic, and lifestyle factors that interact with an infectious trigger of some kind, for example, one or more viruses or bacteria, to stimulate the autoimmune process. This means that when a person with a genetic susceptibility to MS meets up with the environmental trigger or triggers, his or her immune system overreacts in a way that sets off the abnormal autoimmune process. This sounds simple enough, but the question of why some people get MS and others don't remains one of the great mysteries of this disease. Solving this mystery is important because identifying the factors that make some people susceptible to MS and others not would help scientists figure out the cause of MS. And identifying the cause would make it a whole lot easier to find more effective treatment and, eventually, a cure. Gender clues. The fact that MS doesn't occur equally in women and men has long piqued the curiosity of scientists and physicians. It turns out that some interesting differences exist between the sexes, in regard to MS, that is, that may provide important clues to the cause of MS. MS is 2 to 3 times more common in women than in men. However, prior to the onset of puberty, boys are as likely to get MS as girls. Check out Chapter 15 for more info about MS in kids. Men tend to develop MS at a later age than women do, and they're more likely than women to be diagnosed with primary progressive MS. You can read more about the disease courses in the section distinguishing the 4 disease types later in the chapter. Ethnic or racial clues. MS isn't unique to one racial or ethnic group, but certain groups are much more susceptible than others. Scientists are using the following clues to help themselves understand the genetic and environmental factors that may be causing these group differences. MS is most common among Caucasians of Northern European ancestry. African Americans and Hispanics develop MS half as often as Caucasians. Asians develop MS less frequently than Caucasians and generally have different types of symptoms. MS is rare or unheard of in pure Africans, Inuits, and some isolated populations around the world that have never mingled with other groups. Geographical clues. The geographical distribution of MS has been known for a long time. In general, the farther you live from the equator, the greater your chances are of developing MS. Like a lot of other aspects of MS, no one knows why this is true, but here are some possible explanations. Genetic or ethnic. Residents in the temperate areas of the world, except certain groups like the Inuits, tend to be of Northern European descent. Climatic or meteorologic. Residents of the tropics have greater exposure to the sun and vitamin D, which may offer some protection against MS. Infectious. Certain types of infectious agents may be more common in temperate areas of the world. Each of these possible explanations is the subject of intensive investigation. Remember, an interesting wrinkle in the geographical data, which no one can yet explain, suggests that timing may be the key. Data, particularly from Israel and South Africa, suggest that people who migrate from their birthplace before puberty take on the MS risk factor of their new home, whereas people who migrate after puberty maintain the risk level associated with their birthplace. Just remember that these are statistical statements that characterize large groups of people, not single people within that group. This means that these statements provide no kind of guarantee for you or your children. So there's no need to pack your bags and relocate to the tropics. Genetic clues. MS isn't an inherited disease. However, the evidence is quite strong that a genetic factor contributes to a person's risk of developing MS. The following facts point to a genetic component. Approximately 20% of people with MS have a close or distant relative with MS. The risk for someone who has one close relative with MS is 3 to 5%, compared to less than 1% in people without a relative with MS. For a person in a multiplex family, which has several members with MS, the risk of developing MS is even greater. Keep in mind, however, that even within the same family, close relatives can experience different disease courses, symptoms, and levels of disability. If one identical twin develops MS, the risk for the other twin is about 30%, proving that the disease isn't directly inherited. Because identical twins share identical genetic traits, the risk would be 100% if genetics told the whole story. Lifestyle clues. You've probably asked yourself and your doctor 100 times what you did or didn't do to cause your MS. Just remember that it's clear from the study of geography, ethnicity, and genetics that the cause of MS, whatever it turns out to be, isn't anything simple or direct. You didn't do anything to cause MS to happen. However, here are some intriguing findings related to lifestyle. Even though exposure to sunlight and vitamin D is primarily determined by how close to the equator a person lives, it may also be related to time spent outdoors. One study found that people who got extra vitamin D from a daily multivitamin were at a lower risk for MS. Some studies have suggested that dietary factors may play a role in determining a person's susceptibility to MS. For example, it has been suggested that Inuits don't get MS because of their fish-heavy diet. Several studies have suggested that smoking increases a person's risk of developing MS as well as the risk for disease progression, but no one has a clue why this may be true. So if you're looking for yet another reason to quit smoking, its possible relationship to MS is a good one. Remember, separating out these lifestyle findings from other factors is difficult because none of them happen in isolation. Genetics and geography are also operating regardless of one's smoking, sunning, or eating habits. So, in the meantime, flip to chapter 11 for more info about diet and general wellness. Understanding why your MS is as unique as your fingerprint. Here's something to think about. If you went to a large gathering of people with MS, chances are high that you wouldn't meet anyone whose MS is just like yours. MS is so variable from one person to the next, even among people in the same family, that your experience with MS will be unique. Even though the cause of this variability isn't clear, it probably has to do with the genetic and geographic factors we talk about in the section Exploring Possible MS Triggers earlier in the chapter. In addition, the inflammatory process that damages myelin and axons can happen just about anywhere in the central nervous system, with the random targets resulting in different kinds of symptoms. Check out the section Scanning the Possible Symptoms later in the chapter. Distinguishing the four disease courses. Well over a decade ago, a group of MS specialists, researchers, and clinicians got together to develop a common language for talking about MS. The group identified the following four disease courses: relapsing remitting MS, RRMS. MS begins as a relapsing remitting disease about 85% of the time. RRMS is characterized by unpredictable periods of worsening called relapses, exacerbations, or attacks, followed by remissions. A remission may be complete, meaning that the person returns to his or her pre-relapse level of functioning, or partial, meaning that some of the symptoms are likely to be permanent. Secondary progressive MS, SPMS. Within about 10 years, approximately 50% of those who are diagnosed with RRMS transition to SPMS, which is characterized by a steady but not necessarily rapid progression of disability without any remissions. Within about 25 years, a large majority of people make this transition. These folks generally have fewer or no relapses as time goes on. Primary progressive MS, PPMS. For about 10% of people, MS progresses right from the beginning, without any relapses or remissions. PPMS seems to differ from RRMS and SPMS in terms of its underlying disease process. It has less inflammatory action going on in the brain and spinal cord and more tissue degeneration and destruction early on. These differences may be the reason that the current treatments for MS, check them out in Chapter 6, which mainly target the inflammation, work much better in relapsing forms of MS than they do in PPMS. Progressive relapsing MS, PRMS. A very small number of people, less than 5%, are diagnosed initially with a progressive form of the disease, but then experience some relapses down the road. Remember, even though these categories may seem nice and neat, they really aren't. Within each of the groups is a tremendous variability, so don't be surprised if your MS doesn't quite fit any of the descriptions outlined here. For example, regardless of their disease course, some folks may experience very mild, stable MS, sometimes referred to as benign MS, while others may have a more rapidly disabling course. See Chapter 13 for more on dealing with advanced disease. Unfortunately, no one can predict for sure whose MS is gonna do what, which has led most MS experts to conclude that early treatment with one of the available medications, referred to Chapter 6, is the best way to hedge your bets. So even if your MS appears benign at the outset, starting treatment early is your best protection against future progression. Scanning the possible symptoms. MS symptoms can involve virtually any sensory or motor function that's controlled by the central nervous system. This means that the list of possible symptoms is long, including fatigue, by far the most common, visual changes, walking problems, and tremor, Chapter 7, bladder and bowel problems, sexual difficulties, sensory changes, and speech and swallowing problems, Chapter 8, and mood changes and problems with thinking and memory, Chapter 9. Most symptoms tend to come and go, but some may come and stay, and they can range from mild to quite severe. The good news is that most people don't develop all of these symptoms, and most of the symptoms are treatable. Remember, MS symptoms don't show up in any particular order. Often, however, visual changes are what bring someone to the doctor. Then, once in the doctor's office, it's pretty common for someone to remember an episode of one or more of these symptoms during high school or college that came and went without anyone paying much mind. That's why your doctor asks you so many questions and takes such a careful medical history when trying to arrive at a diagnosis. Flip to Chapter 2 for information about the diagnostic process. Reviewing the MS treatment menu. Reading about all the MS symptoms can definitely be an eye-opening experience. In fact, both your eyes and your mouth may be hanging wide open when you do. But try not to panic. You aren't likely to experience every symptom described in this book, and with the help of your treatment team, flip to chapter 4 for details, you can learn how to manage the symptoms that occur and take steps to control the disease as much as possible. Because MS is so complex, treatment involves several different strategies, all of which are discussed in detail in part 2. However, for now, here are snapshots of several steps you can take to feel and function up to snuff. Use disease-modifying therapy. Your doctor will discuss with you whether you're a candidate for treatment with one of the disease-modifying therapies. Flip to Chapter 6 for details. For example, if you have relapsing remitting MS or secondary progressive MS and are having intermittent relapses, you're probably a candidate. These medications don't cure MS, but they do reduce the frequency and severity of relapses, and they probably slow the progression of the disease to some degree. Manage your relapses. Relapses, also called attacks or exacerbations, can be treated with corticosteroids if necessary. Even though the corticosteroids don't have any long-term impact on the disease, they're often effective in reducing the inflammation and bringing the relapse to an end more quickly. When you have a relapse, you and your doctor will decide whether the symptoms are interfering enough with your everyday activities to warrant treatment. Check out Chapter 6 for more on managing your relapses. And the rehab team, see Chapter 4, can help you with exercise tips and other management strategies so you can get back in the swing of things as quickly as possible. Manage your symptoms. You and your healthcare team will work together to manage your symptoms effectively. See Chapters 7, 8, and 9. Successful symptom management relies on effective teamwork, with you being a key player on your team. Your job is to report symptoms promptly, follow through with the treatment plan that the team develops for you, and provide feedback on what treatments do and don't work for you. And remember, as your symptoms change, so will the strategies you use to manage them. Work with the rehabilitation team. Like the mechanics that keep your car finely tuned and road ready, the rehab team helps you getting gear. Check out Chapter 4 for more on this team. Physical and occupational therapists can help you do what you want to do, comfortably and safely, and prevent yucky complications. They're the experts when it comes to finding the right tools to help you do what you want to do. Speech-language pathologists deal with problems related to communication, swallowing, and cognitive functions like thinking, remembering, and processing information. Promote your overall health and wellness. Feeling your best involves more than just managing your MS, so it's important that you not focus on your MS to the exclusion of your general health. Unfortunately, being diagnosed with MS doesn't protect you from the health problems that plague all mortals. This means that you have to get the proper nutrition, exercise, and preventative health care, Chapter 11, and you have to manage the stresses of your everyday life, Chapter 12. Taking these important steps can help you feel healthy and well, in spite of a chronic illness. Seek out emotional support. Living with MS isn't a piece of cake. Even for those whose symptoms remain mild and manageable, the unpredictability alone is enough to stress people out. So, Chapter 3 shows you how to deal with your new diagnosis and come to grips with a chronic illness. The fact is that adjusting to this intrusion in your life and your family's life is an ongoing process that begins with your first symptoms and continues through all the changes that MS can bring. Remember, fortunately, you don't have to cope with this alone. Throughout this book, we suggest ways to get the support you need from your healthcare team, from the National MS Society and other organizations, and from those close to you. Check out Part 4 for suggestions on how to communicate with others about your MS and how to deal with the emotional stresses that MS can cause for you and the people you love. Recognizing how your MS affects your loved ones. When you throw a pebble into a lake or stream, there's always a ripple effect. Getting diagnosed with MS is similar because when one person in a family is diagnosed with MS, the entire family is affected by it. To help you adjust, we devote Chapter 15 to making MS a part of your family. Even though the symptoms are yours, your loved ones share everything from the impact of those symptoms on daily life to the financial pressures caused by MS. And like you, each family member is going to react to all of these challenges. talking about the tough stuff. One of the first hurdles for family members is figuring out how to talk comfortably and honestly with one another about the intrusion of MS in their lives. No one asked for MS, and no one likes it, so all of you are likely to feel sad, anxious, and maybe even a little resentful about the whole thing. Talking about these heavy-duty feelings can be difficult, particularly when you're all worried about creating more upset or worry for people you love. Remember, family members also tend to have different ways of dealing with tough stuff. For example, you may be a talker while your partner is the strong, silent type. These different and sometimes conflicting coping styles are another barrier to communication. So Chapter 15 offers you strategies for starting and continuing the tough conversations. Keeping daily life on track. As you may have noticed, MS symptoms can disrupt the rhythms of daily life. You may find that you can't do some things as well or as fast as you used to do them, and that you need to swap some chores and responsibilities with other family members. If you and your family members are finding that plans, especially outings and trips, are disrupted by pesky symptoms or unexpected relapses, check out Chapter 15 for ideas on how to keep the good times rolling, and Chapter 23 for 10 traveling tips to keep in mind. Remember, because MS symptoms are so unpredictable, you may all need to be a lot more flexible and creative than you have ever been before. Your goal as a family is to make sure that MS doesn't interfere with your plans and priorities any more than absolutely necessary. Maintaining healthy partnerships. Couples generally don't know what they're getting into with that in sickness and in health line. So chances are you're probably learning from scratch how to adapt your partnership to the challenges of MS. In Chapter 15, we provide strategies to help you keep your partnership feeling comfortable and balanced. And in Chapter 8, we tell you how to manage the symptoms that can interfere with your sexual relationship. Regardless of the path your MS takes, the goal is to maintain a healthy, mutually satisfying partnership. If you aren't already in a committed relationship, you're probably in the dating scene, which is challenging enough without MS symptoms getting in the way. If this sounds like your situation, turn to Chapter 14 for tips on how to talk about your MS with a prospective partner. Becoming confident parents. When young adults are diagnosed with MS, some of the first questions they ask are about having kids. Young women want to know how a pregnancy will affect their MS and whether their MS will harm the baby. Men and women both have questions about how MS will affect their ability to be good parents. Although Chapter 16 gives you all the details about conception, pregnancy, childbirth, and breastfeeding, here's a sneak preview. Women and men with MS can be terrific parents of healthy, happy children. We suggest some important stuff to keep in mind when making your family plans, such as the unpredictability of MS, the depth of your financial resources, and the strength of your support system. And we recommend some strategies to help you and your partner come to the decisions that are right for both of you. But we don't stop with childbirth, because that's over in a jiffy. Chapter 17 is full of parenting tips, including how to talk to your kids about MS, how to keep your MS symptoms from getting in the way of quality time with your kids, and how to keep MS from being the center of everyone's attention. Minimizing the impact of MS on work and play. MS is generally a relapsing, remitting disease, which means that symptoms come and go in an unpredictable way. So don't make big decisions about any major life activities in the middle of a relapse or a particularly stressful week. Too many people end up leaving the workforce when they're first diagnosed or during a subsequent relapse, only to discover a few weeks or months down the road that they're feeling fine. But now they're unemployed. If stress is getting you down, flip to Chapter 12 for ways to manage it. If you're considering leaving your job because of your MS, be sure to take advantage of all the legal protections that are available to you before thinking about disability retirement. The Americans with Disabilities Act, ADA, and other statutes are in place to help you stay employed as long as you want and are able to. Chapter 18 describes the provisions of the ADA, gives you pointers on how and when to disclose your MS at the workplace, and walks you through the steps for requesting accommodations from your employer. Remember, fun and recreation are just as important as work. Too often, people begin to give up activities they can no longer do easily or well. Before they know it, they've given up a lot of the things that make their life fun, full, and interesting. We talk a lot in this book about getting comfortable with doing things differently. after you decide that it's okay to be creative, you'll find a way to do just about everything that's important to you. People with MS swim, ski, sail, play golf, go camping, and travel all over the world. Chapter 7 describes the tools and strategies that can help you get around some of your symptoms, and Chapter 23 gives you 10 tips for travel. Protecting your quality of life. Given the unpredictability of MS, you're probably wondering what you can do to safeguard your quality of life. The short answer is you have to be a master at thoughtful planning and decision-making. We know that most folks don't enjoy second-guessing the future, but the best way to ensure your comfort and security down the road is to get all your ducks in a row now. So check out Chapter 19 for info on how to ensure that your insurance coverage is the best that it can be, and Chapter 20, which gives you tips on how to plan for an unpredictable future. In the meantime, here's the shorthand prescription for protecting your quality of life. Hope for the best, but plan for the worst. Remember, you aren't alone. Lots of people are with you on your MS path, including the scientists who continue to look for answers, the health professionals who want to partner with you in your care, and the voluntary health organizations such as the National MS Society that offer information and support. We offer this book as a friendly guide through the process. Chapter 2. So, Doc, what do I have? Getting a diagnosis. In this chapter, sorting out the diagnostic criteria, discovering the tools used to diagnose MS, realizing why an MS diagnosis takes so long. Diagnosing multiple sclerosis, MS, is a bit like going on a treasure hunt. You need to collect a lot of stuff in order to get the prize, or in this case, the booby prize. To make your treasure hunt just a bit easier, in this chapter, we discuss the diagnostic criteria of MS. And we describe the various kinds of tests your doctor may use to find the cause for whatever symptoms or problems you're having. We also explain why confirming a diagnosis of MS can sometimes take a long time. You can believe us when we tell you that physicians today are as eager as you are to find the right answer. Unlike the old days when little help was available to a person with MS, now several safe and effective treatments are available to help slow the disease and reduce the risk of permanent neurologic damage. So, a prompt, accurate diagnosis is a goal that you and your doctor share. Clarifying the diagnostic criteria. One of the reasons that MS can be so difficult to diagnose is that neurologists, physicians who specialize in the diagnosis and treatment of nervous system disorders, haven't yet found any specific tests that can be used to identify it. For example, you can't culture it like you do with strep throat or detect it with a blood test like you can with diabetes. Instead, an MS diagnosis is a clinical one, which means that the doctor pieces it together from a variety of sources, including your personal and family history, the symptoms you report, the findings on the neurologic examination, and whatever other tests may be needed. So if you go to your primary care physician with problems or symptoms that look or sound like MS, he or she may recommend that you see a neurologist to help sort out the evidence. Chapter 4 gives you tips on how to find the right neurologist and other MS specialists for your healthcare team. Before we describe exactly what's involved in the diagnostic process, you first have to understand what the neurologist is trying to find. In order to make a diagnosis of MS, he or she must find objective evidence of dissemination in time and space. Yes, it's truly a mouthful, but it's a good term to know because it's the basis for the long-established diagnostic criteria for multiple sclerosis. In a nutshell, what this term means is the diagnosis requires objective evidence of two relapses, in other words, two episodes of demyelination in the central nervous system, CNS, which includes the brain, spinal cord, and optic nerves. Demyelination is the term used to describe the damage caused to the myelin coating surrounding the nerve fibers. A relapse, also known as an attack, exacerbation, episode, or flare, is defined as the sudden appearance or worsening of an MS symptom or symptoms that lasts at least 24 hours, although in reality, most attacks last several days or weeks. Take a look at Chapter 1 for a description of the disease process. Also see the section Identifying a Clinically Isolated Syndrome, CIS, later in this chapter if your doctor says that you may have MS because you've experienced a single clinical episode or event caused by demyelination in your CNS. The two relapses must be separated in time by at least 1 month and in space, as evidenced by areas of inflammation or damage in different areas of the CNS. There must be no other explanation for these relapses or for the symptoms that the person is experiencing. In other words, the physician must rule out all other possible diseases or conditions that may be causing the neurological problems. In the early days, neurologists had to rely exclusively on a person's medical history, current symptoms, and the results of the neurologic exam, which we describe in the upcoming section, Getting Familiar with the Neurologist's Diagnostic Tools, to see if these criteria for an MS diagnosis had been met. In 2001, the International Panel on the Diagnosis of Multiple Sclerosis, led by W.I. McDonald, FRCP, issued a refinement of the criteria, now referred to as the McDonald criteria, that described how certain kinds of laboratory tests could be used to provide additional evidence of dissemination in time and space. Remember, in other words, the diagnosis of MS still requires evidence of at least two relapses that have occurred in different parts of the CNS and different points in time, but now more tools are at the neurologist's disposal for collecting that evidence. The McDonald criteria continue to be a work in progress. The International Panel met in 2005 and again in 2010 to review data collected since 2001 and to tweak the criteria. The latest revisions, conveniently called the 2010 revisions to the McDonald diagnostic criteria for MS, help enhance the speed and accuracy of an MS diagnosis. You can take a peek at the specifics on the National Multiple Sclerosis Society website at nationalmssociety.org/clinician-resources. Getting familiar with the neurologist's diagnostic tools. Fortunately, the MS world has moved beyond the days of the hot bath test, when physicians used to put people in a hot bath to try and bring out MS symptoms. They used this quick and clean method because they knew that heat tends to slow nerve conduction in someone with MS and cause their symptoms to flare up. Check out Chapter 6 for info about the effects of heat on MS. Today, neurologists rely on a person's medical history, the neurologic exam, and a variety of laboratory tests, which the following sections discuss in greater detail, to help confirm the diagnosis and rule out other conditions. Here are some other conditions that your doctor needs to rule out before confirming a diagnosis. Infections such as Lyme disease, syphilis, and HIV/AIDS. Inflammatory diseases such as systemic lupus erythematosus or other causes of vasculitis. Metabolic problems such as vitamin B12 deficiency or certain genetic disorders. Diseases of the spine. Certain types of tumors. All these conditions and more are running through your doctor's mind as he or she tries to find an explanation for your symptoms. To access the National MS Society's information about the diagnostic process, go to nationalmssociety.org/diagnose. Medical history. The neurologist's ability to piece together the evidence of a diagnosis is only as good as the information that he or she has given. Calling ahead to see if the neurologist would like records sent before the visit is a good idea. If not, bring all your medical records and test results with you, and be prepared to answer a lot of questions about past and present complaints, relevant family history, the places you've traveled, your use of alcohol or drugs, any medications you take, and any allergies you may have to medications or the environment. This information is valuable in three ways. It helps the neurologist rule out other problems. For example, a virus contracted while visiting another part of the world, neurologic problems resulting from substance abuse, and side effects from medications. It lets the neurologist know whether you have any family history of MS or other autoimmune diseases. It can indicate whether you have ever experienced any symptoms, no matter how mild or fleeting, that may be indicative of MS. Examining your history is one of the primary ways the neurologist has for identifying past MS relapses. For example, suppose Susie goes to her neurologist complaining of numbness and tingling down her right side that began about a week ago. When taking her history, the neurologist finds that Susie experienced an episode of blurred vision when she was a teenager. The blurred vision passed after a few days, and no one gave it another thought. However, for the doctor, these separate events suggest a diagnosis of MS. Remember, the point is, don't show up empty-handed for your appointment with the neurologist. He or she can take your history and examine you, but can't give you any definitive information or even know what tests to recommend without reviewing your records, including previous test results and other doctors' findings. neurologic exam. The neurologic exam is an important tool both for diagnosing MS and for assessing disease progression over time. Understanding the components of this examination is important because you're likely to experience all or some of them many times over the course of the disease. During the neurologic exam, the doctor will evaluate both your symptoms and signs of MS. Symptoms are the problems or changes you're reporting. Because every person experiences and describes symptoms differently, they're always very subjective. However, this subjectivity doesn't make the symptoms less important. It just means that the neurologist has to rely on your experience of them to try to get a handle on what the problems may be and how severe they are. Examples of symptoms include problems with vision, walking, fatigue, bladder or bowel control, and so on. On the other hand, signs are more measurable and objective pieces of evidence that you may have never even noticed, including involuntary eye movements, altered reflexes, or evidence of spasticity, tightness in your legs. Check out Chapter 7 for more information about this common symptom. Remember, the neurologic exam usually evaluates the following. Functioning of the cranial nerves. The neurologist evaluates the 12 individual nerves in your head that control the senses, such as vision and touch, and activities related to talking and swallowing. The neurologist can check for damage in your optic nerve by testing your visual acuity using an eye chart and by looking through an ophthalmoscope to examine the head of the optic nerve, the optic disc. A pale optic disc may indicate earlier damage to the nerve, even if you don't remember ever experiencing any problem with your vision. The doctor also checks for double or blurred vision by evaluating your eye movements, abnormal responses of the pupils, and other signs of neurologic damage. The neurologist also assesses the movements of your tongue and throat, evaluates the strength of your facial muscles, and checks for reduced or altered sensations in your face. Strength and coordination. The neurologist may evaluate your strength by pushing on your arms and legs and asking you to resist the pressure. You may also be asked to squeeze his or her hand as hard as you can to determine your level of strength. To evaluate your coordination, the neurologist may ask you to do the following. Walk down the hall so he or she can assess your speed and stability. Stand and move the heel of one foot up and down the opposite leg, which is often called the heel-knee-shin test. Walk on your heels and then on your toes. Walk a tandem gait by placing the heel of one foot directly against the toe of the other foot in alternating fashion. Touch his or her finger and then your nose many times rapidly, called the finger-to-nose test, first with the eyes open and then with them closed. Sensation. The neurologist may evaluate your position sense by asking you to close your eyes and describe where your hands and feet are in space. He or she may test your vibration sense by placing a tuning fork against various parts of your body. The doctor may also touch you softly or use very gentle pinpricks or a cotton ball at various points on your arms or legs to check for changes in sensitivity to touch. Reflexes. The neurologist may check your reflexes at the ankle, knee, and elbow to see if they're equal on both sides of your body. Testing for the Babinski reflex, named after the French neurologist Joseph Babinski, is also important because this abnormal sign in anyone more than 1 year old is always an indication of damage in the central nervous system. To do this test, the doctor runs a blunt instrument down the side of your foot from the heel to the little toe. The normal response to the stimulus is to curl your toes, as generally happens whenever a person's foot is tickled. The abnormal Babinski reflex response, which is common in MS, is for your toes to fan upward and outward. The presence of Lermite's sign. To determine if you have this neurologic sign, named after Jean Lermite, another French neurologist, the neurologist may ask whether you ever experience a sudden, fleeting, electric-like shock or buzzing sensation down your body or limbs when you bend your head forward. Your neurologist can use this neurologic sign to confirm damage in your CNS. Even though Lermite's sign can occasionally occur for other reasons, it's generally caused by MS. Remember, the neurologist probably will do this kind of in-depth exam only during your initial visit. Unless you've experienced a major change in your symptoms or you're participating in a clinical trial, research study of some kind, he or she will most likely do an abbreviated version of the exam during subsequent checkups, focusing primarily on any new problems you may have. Various medical tests. When a patient's medical history and neurologic exam provide evidence of two episodes of demyelination that are separated in time and space, no other tests are technically needed to make the MS diagnosis. However, other tests are used to confirm the diagnosis or to help the neurologist identify a second episode of demyelination if it wasn't apparent from the history or exam, and to rule out other diseases that could be masquerading as MS. We explain these tests in the following sections. Read on for details. Magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. The magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, scan is a highly sensitive, non-invasive way to view areas of damage in the CNS. MRI uses a strong magnet, radio frequency pulses, and a specialized computer software to create detailed pictures of your brain and spinal cord. A contrast material called gadolinium, delivered by intravenous infusion during the scan, is often used to highlight active areas of inflammation in the CNS caused by a breakdown in the blood-brain barrier, BBB. The BBB generally prevents bad stuff from passing from your bloodstream into your CNS. Check out Chapter 1 for more information about how MS affects your immune system. As part of the diagnostic process, most neurologists want to see an MRI scan of the brain and spinal cord, even though it can't, by itself, determine if a patient has MS. Normal aging and other diseases besides MS can cause lesions or, more informally, spots or scars in the brain that look like MS. So your doctor has to use other tools to ensure an accurate diagnosis. Also, neurologists know that about 5% of people with definite MS can have a normal-appearing brain MRI scan, at least for a while, which means that scanning may need to be repeated in a few months in order to help confirm the diagnosis or rule it out. However, the longer the brain scan remains normal, the more doubtful the MS diagnosis becomes. Different types of MRI scans yield different kinds of information. When studying your MRI images, the neurologist is looking for evidence of new disease activity as well as signs of prior attacks. The telltale signs of prior attacks may include old lesions, those spots or scars, or damage to the axons, which are the parts of nerve cells that carry messages from one cell to another. MRI signs of damaged axons are called hypointensities, or black holes. He or she is also looking to find the total amount of damage that has occurred, which is referred to as lesion load. Flip to Chapter 1 for more information about the damage that MS can cause to the myelin and the axons in the CNS. Tip: be sure to ask your neurologist to review your MRI images with you so that he or she can explain what kinds of changes have occurred in your brain or spinal cord and what these changes indicate about your MS. Because docs tend to use a lot of technical jargon when they talk about MRI scans, be sure to ask questions if you don't understand the information you're being given. A conventional MRI scanner is an enclosed cylindrical magnet. During the scanning procedure, you must lie perfectly still for several seconds to several minutes at a time for about 45 minutes. If you have difficulty in enclosed spaces, for example, if you suffer from claustrophobia, the referring physician can give you a sedating medication prior to the scan. As an alternative, some MRI facilities offer machines with openings on the sides. To date, however, scans taken in open-sided machines don't have the same degree of clarity as conventional scanners. Warning: because an MRI scanner uses strong magnets to obtain images of the body, patients who have cardiac pacemakers or certain kinds of metal implants can't have this test. When scheduling the scan, the MRI office staff member will ask whether you have any prosthetic joints, a pacemaker, any implanted ports or infusion catheters, an intrauterine device, IUD, or any metal plates, pins, or screws from prior surgeries. Not all metal causes a problem, so don't assume that you can't have an MRI just because you've had a pin or screw implanted sometime in the past. The staff member will also ask if you have any body tattoos or tattooed eyeliner, as some people with tattoos report swelling or burning in the tattooed areas, and some tattoos contain metallic components that can interfere with image quality. At the time of the scan, the MRI technician asks you to remove anything that may interfere with the quality of the images of your head, such as hairpins, jewelry, eyeglasses, hearing aids, and removable dental work. Because of the loud banging noise made by the scanner, the technician can offer you earplugs or earphones to wear during the procedure. If the gadolinium enhancement we mentioned earlier in this section is required, he or she inserts an intravenous needle into your vein. He or she then positions you comfortably, sort of, on a sliding table that rolls into the cylindrical tube. You can communicate with the technician at all times in the event that you need assistance. Other than the discomfort you feel from having to lie perfectly still in a confined space with loud noises banging in your ears, sounds fun, huh? The MRI procedure is painless. Evoked potential testing. Evoked potential tests, or EP tests, are recordings of the central nervous system's electrical response to the stimulation of specific nerve pathways, visual, auditory, and sensory, that are commonly affected in MS. These electrical responses are recorded from brainwaves by using electrodes taped to your head. Because demyelination results in a slowing of response time, EPs can sometimes provide evidence of demyelination along nerve pathways that isn't otherwise apparent to the neurologist from the medical history or neurologic exam. For example, if Susie goes to her neurologist with one symptom that's characteristic of MS, such as numbness and tingling or extreme fatigue, and she reports an episode of blurred vision a few years ago, the neurologist may request visual evoked potential, VEP, testing to find out whether the blurred vision was caused by an episode of demyelination of the optic nerve, called optic neuritis. Remember, of the three types of EP tests that neurologists use, visual, auditory, and sensory, the VEP test is generally considered the most useful in diagnosing MS because 80% of people with the disease have slowed responses on this test. So if Susie's VEP is abnormal, her neurologist has evidence of two separate areas of demyelination, helping to confirm the MS diagnosis. But if Susie's VEP is normal, the doctor needs to continue looking for additional evidence of demyelination. When you're undergoing an EP test, a technician applies gel to promote electrical conduction and electrodes to your head and body at certain locations that are determined by the type of response being recorded. For example, when visual evoked responses are recorded, the electrodes are placed at the back of your scalp over the brain areas that register visual stimuli. For other EP tests, the electrodes are placed at different points on the head and body. Different stimuli are delivered for each test. For example, a strobe light or screen with a checkerboard pattern is flashed for the visual test. Clicking noises or a tone are delivered through headphones for the auditory test, and a mild electrical pulse is delivered at the wrist or knee for the general sensory test. The procedure, which takes approximately 45 minutes per test, is non-invasive and completely painless, except for the slight, and we mean slight, discomfort caused by the mild shock given for the sensory evoked potential test. Lumbar puncture. The lumbar puncture, or LP, also known as the spinal tap, allows your neurologist to examine the cerebrospinal fluid, CSF, that cushions and protects your brain and spinal cord. The doctor obtains the CSF by inserting a spinal needle into your lower spine. The CSF is then analyzed for evidence of an abnormal immune response in the CNS. Specifically, the neurologist is looking for increased production of certain immune proteins, IgG. Using a method called protein electrophoresis, some of this IgG may show up as stripes or bands called oligoclonal bands. Nearly 90% of patients with MS have these bands, making them an important piece of evidence in the diagnostic process. Remember, because other conditions can also produce oligoclonal bands, and because 10 to 21% of people with MS can actually have normal cerebrospinal fluid findings, the LP by itself can't make the diagnosis. However, the findings can help the neurologist build the case for an MS diagnosis or exclude it. The LP, which generally isn't high on anyone's list of fun things to do, can be performed in about 20 minutes in your neurologist's office. The doctor injects a local anesthetic into your back. He or she then inserts a spinal needle into the fluid-filled space that surrounds the nerves below the bottom end of your spinal cord. Withdraws a small amount of CSF, we promise that it's really not as awful as it sounds, and then asks you to straighten your legs. Immediately after removing the needle, the doctor applies pressure to the puncture site and asks you to lie still for about 30 to 45 minutes. This waiting period helps reduce the risk of severe headache caused by the internal leakage of CSF, which occurs following approximately 20% of LP procedures. The doctor also recommends rest and plenty of fluids after the LP. Blood tests. Even though no definite blood tests exist for MS, blood tests can positively rule out other causes for neurologic symptoms, such as Lyme disease, collagen vascular diseases, certain hereditary disorders, and HIV/AIDS. Identifying a clinically isolated syndrome. A clinically isolated syndrome, CIS, is a first clinical episode lasting at least 24 hours that is caused by inflammation and demyelination in the CNS. It can't be diagnosed as MS because one episode doesn't meet the criterion for dissemination in time, described in the Clarifying the Diagnostic Criteria section earlier in this chapter. A person with CIS can have a single neurologic sign or symptom, for example, an attack of optic neuritis that's caused by a single lesion, or more than one sign or symptom, for example, an attack of optic neuritis accompanied by weakness on one side that results from lesions in more than one site. A person who experiences a clinically isolated syndrome may or may not go on to develop MS. So if Susie goes to the neurologist with a single attack of optic neuritis, the doctor's challenge is to determine what the chances are that she's going to experience a second demyelinating event in the future, which would fulfill the diagnostic criteria for MS. Neurologists know from CIS studies that when a person with CIS also has brain lesions on an MRI scan that are similar to those seen in MS, the patient has a high risk of a second demyelinating event, and therefore a diagnosis of MS, within several years. They also know that the more lesions there are, the higher the risk. However, individuals who experience CIS with no brain lesions on an MRI scan are at relatively low risk for developing MS over the same time period. This means that the neurologist is going to look carefully at Susie's brain MRI and repeat it over time to help figure out the next steps to take. To date, 4 large studies have been carried out, and 2 more are underway, to determine whether early treatment of CIS delays the second demyelinating event, and therefore the diagnosis of MS. So far, each of the interferon medications, Avonex and Rebif, interferon beta-1a, beta-seron and Xdavia, interferon beta-1b, as well as glatiramer acetate, Copaxone, have been shown to delay the second demyelinating event. See Chapter 6 for more on these medications. Avonex, Betaseron, Xdavia, and Copaxone have been FDA approved for this use. The manufacturers of Rebif have submitted an application to the FDA for approval of Rebif to treat CIS. Remember, as with many other situations in MS, there are no right or wrong answers when it comes to treatment of CIS. Some people are ready to begin an injectable medication this early in the game, before the diagnosis has been confirmed, while others aren't. The best strategy is to review your options thoroughly with your neurologist. Flip to Chapter 6 for more information about the importance of early treatment. Understanding why the road to diagnosis can have detours. Given all the tests available to help confirm or rule out a diagnosis of MS, you're probably wondering why it sometimes takes so long for the diagnosis to be confirmed. In the old days, before MRI technology and EP testing, a diagnosis could sometimes take years if a person's second relapse didn't occur for a long time. Fortunately, neurologists today usually arrive at answers more quickly because the available tests help them to identify other areas of demyelination that never caused recognizable symptoms. But, and this is a big but, neurologists can't make the diagnosis until evidence of a second relapse is found, separated in time and space from the first. So if a person has a neurologic episode of some kind, but then doesn't have another episode or any new lesions characteristic of MS for several years, doctors have no way to make a definitive diagnosis. Flip to the section Identifying a Clinically Isolated Syndrome earlier in the chapter for details about the situation. Living with the possibility of MS hanging over their heads is difficult for people. However, it is also difficult being told they have MS when it turns out later that they really don't. Tip: for this reason, getting a second opinion, preferably from an MS specialist neurologist, is generally a good idea. See Chapter 4. Don't worry about offending your doctor by seeking a second opinion. A good doctor won't mind at all. In fact, the best docs encourage it.
Chapter 3. You have MS. So now what? In this chapter, dealing with your reactions to the news, figuring out what to do and whom to tell, dealing with the long-term emotions and unpredictability of MS, sorting through your options. Now that you have a diagnosis of multiple sclerosis, MS, you're probably trying to figure out what happens next. That's a good question, because one of the major challenges we talk about in this chapter is how unpredictable MS can be. At this point, you may be experiencing one or more uncomfortable or annoying symptoms, or the symptoms that led to your diagnosis may have all but disappeared. Either way, you now have to deal with the fact that MS is part of your life, and no two people deal with it exactly the same way. In this chapter, we describe the most common reactions people have to receiving an MS diagnosis, as well as the longer-term feelings that can come into play as time goes on. We also recommend some initial steps for your MS journey and propose strategies for dealing with the changes, challenges, and choices that a chronic illness like MS can bring to your life. First things first, sorting out your feelings. Everyone's initial reaction to getting an MS diagnosis is going to be different. Whatever you're experiencing, whether it's shock, denial, anxiety, anger, or even relief, or some combination of all of these, keep in mind that these reactions are normal, and that you and those who care about you are going to re-experience some variation of them whenever MS brings new symptoms and challenges into your life. Remember, as tempting as it may seem, trying to ignore these feelings or keep them under wraps.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.